The following program contains adult language, poor taste in jokes, racial slurs, political slurs, slants, and all sorts of things that if you are sensitive and have a delicate constitution, you should probably go watch Teletubbies. You are warned.
Hey kids, welcome back to Roto Talk.
Hey kids, welcome back. This is going to be a fun one. This is a video that I've wanted to do for a while, just because I think there's a lot of confusion out there, a lot of questions out there, and it might be something that deters people from getting into gas boats. So what we're going to do, we're going to go over gas RC boat two stroke, Zenoa specifically in this case, gas engine troubleshooting, and maybe we'll do some maintenance. Probably gonna be a long video because I'm gonna try to recreate scenarios here. We'll see what happens. So if I miss anything or you guys have any questions, please let me know. But this is geared for people that don't necessarily know a lot about two-stroke engines, okay? Two-stroke, whether it's in a boat or a weed eater even. Boat engines and weed eater engines are not the same, okay? Weed eaters, chainsaws, stuff like that are much more lower RPM than like a Zenoa or a Tiger King or whatever the case may be. Red Lines, Zenoa. But anyway, so we're going to go over the two principles of two-stroke engines. The first one that's like in your weed eater normally, and things like that, maybe dirt bikes, especially dirt bikes, things like that, two-strokes. They even make a two-stroke motocross anymore? Can't remember. But anyway, those are reed valve engines in most cases. Okay, so instead of valves, you've got reeds, intake and exhaust reed valves, okay? And they're little pieces of metal, very thin metal, almost looks like shim stock, like this. And they breathe in and out, kind of like valves in a four-stroke do. Then there's chambered two-strokes. Chambered two-strokes are what we run in our boats, okay? So it's basically utilizing the cutaways, if you will, in the cylinders of the engine, okay, for intake and exhaust. So we're going to try to go over a bunch of stuff here. So we're going to use the old T44 here. I've got my external water pump hooked up, so when we do start it, it doesn't blow up. That's just a little thing that I whipped up today. Yeah, push the button, pumps water out of the tank, pumps it through the head, comes back. I actually put food coloring in it because I want to be able to see that, if it's circulating, and it'll fuse back, just in case there's a clog or something. Runs off a 3S battery, and this is a good size, probably quart, in through the head, out through the head. I'm not taking any rudder stuff off or anything like that. It's just for the bench. It's not for running for hours on end, because everybody out there is going to be like, oh, it's going to heat up, and it's going to blow up. Nah, it won't. It'll be perfectly fine. Plus, I leave it out here. And in the fall and winter months, trust me, it'll be cool. Might even put some antifreeze in it for the winter. So anyway, we're going to go over some basics of these engines. They're very, very straightforward. We're going to go over, real quick, verbal stuff. All right? For instance, hydrolock. Hydrolocks when you either have too much fuel in the engine or too much water in the engine, like if you had flipped it and sucked in a lot of water, and you literally can't even pull it. Now, when you can't pull it, it can be one of three things usually. Okay, either you recoil south of cheese, or something in the recoil, the prowl, I never remember the name of that. Anyway, a little grabber dude, that either came undone or something to that nature. It won't start. It won't pull. Another reason could be hydrolock. Like I said, too much fuel, or I mean, if you have that much fuel in there, you've really flooded the shit out of it. But or if you flipped it, I've had that many times where you didn't kill it fast enough and it ingested water. That's another hydrolock. And the other reason it won't pull and rotate in most cases is if you threw a crank or you threw a connecting rod, something like that, internal engine damage. But most of the time, that can be pretty easily detected. So one of the things I would do if you can't pull on the pull start, I've already loosened the spark plug. Take out the spark plug and see if you can rotate it then. if you can, it's a hydrolock, okay? Too much fuel, too much water. So if that is the case, literally hold the boat upside down and pull the crap out of it. And it'll puke out water for days, or fuel if that's the case. Or if you have an electric start with a belt like this, I'll cover the head just so I don't get a face full of schmutz. And vroom, I zoom it up until it goes. You like that sound effect? So yeah, and that's going to be a hydrolock, either a flood or a water flood, one of the two in most cases. If it still doesn't rotate like this, my next thing that I would try, if your boat doesn't have a clutch, this is for non-clutch boats, okay, is literally take a towel, if you have a sharp prop, rotate the crankshaft in the back. See if it'll go then. Either direction, okay? Now, the pole start, you're not going to go clockwise. You're only going to be able to go this way because of the clutch inside, or the single bearing. That's one way to check. Or if you then, if it still doesn't rotate at that point, take off these four Allen bolts in the back, pull this off, the prowl will be under there, and then manually try to rotate it with your fingers. If it still doesn't rotate, you've either thrown something inside, meaning connecting rod, or you've overheated. That's another one that could do it too. I have done that. Well, I actually didn't. I think my buddy Don did that when we were at the river in Ohio with his cracker. He had a brand new 26cc engine, got weeds or cotton or schmutz, whatever, up in the rudder, blocked his water line, overheated the engine, phew, seized up, and we rebuilt it. I rebuilt it for him. Just did a real quick hone on the cylinder, put a new piston, new ring, pretty basic stuff. That's why it's very important to always make sure you can see water coming out of your boat. The exhaust header, not the most critical thing in the world if you don't have that cooled. Okay? So, for instance, say you were at the lake and you were running, and part of your rudder got clogged. You got a double pickup rudder in some cases, like I do. One of those gets clogged up. Well, make sure it's not the cylinder one. You can run without a head cooler. That ain't the end of the world at all. Especially in an open cotton, well, this isn't really open, but it's open to from there back. So yes, always make sure your head. Your cooling for your head, the input always is the low side. The output is always the high side. Same thing with your header. Reason being, air, hot air rises, right? So it's going to naturally flow up. Capillary effect. Okay, actually thermodynamic effect. Okay, pretty simple. So, spark plug. I prefer NGK in the boats, you know, when it comes to real motors, like motorcycles. I started building motorcycles and playing with engines when I was 10 or 11 years old, and I just never had, I always liked NGK better. But for these engines, I haven't really noticed a hell of a lot of difference. The spark plug tells the tale. I don't know how well you can see this, but it's kind of a nice, let's see if I got a flashlight. Nice brown topina in there, okay? If it's really, really black and gross, you're running way too rich. If it's really, really light brown and like almost white, or it is white, you're running way too lean. So the spark plug tells you a lot of information. That will literally, now you have to run your engine for more, if it's a brand new engine or a brand new plug, you have to run it for more than 5 minutes, obviously. You know, give it a good tank through it, see what it looks like. I've known guys that literally will buy a box of plugs and to change them every single time they run just to see how that works. I just wire wheel it, but I'm pretty good at guessing engines in, you know, in the beginning, so I don't worry about that too much. A lot of people ask about the gap setting. Gap settings were not really that important now with digital ignitions or when you're using a coil stator type of setup like this. When you were running points in a condenser in four cycles, two strokes, whatever, where you had a lobe on the cam that actually opened and closed your points, then this was much more crucial because you weren't generating that much amperage to jump the spark. So it was really, really critical to have this. With electronic ignitions, which is what these have now, not as critical as you think. 99% of the time, actually 100% of the time, honestly, you can take it out of the box, stick it in your boat, and run. Yeah, I have never had a problem unless this electrode is really bent up. Well, it's not the electrode, but the arm is really bent up or totally grounding out, getting continuity against that electrode. Okay, so stock for a Zenoa 30 or 26 or Tiger King, pretty much anything, 25,000. So if you really want to be that way, take a feeler gauge, 25,000, stick it in there, and you should feel a little bit of drag. Not much. Yeah, close enough. I wouldn't really worry about it. Unless you're going to have, you know, a really, you can usually look at this, you know, anything and see, oh, that's too big, that's too little. It's not that critical, guys. The days of pre-ignition and stuff like that with a electronic ignition system is pretty much over. Spark plug technology has come a long way too. Like in your car, when's the last time you replaced the spark plugs in your car? Unless it was just part of a routine thing, probably not that long ago. So there's three things you need for a gasoline engine. Notice I said gasoline, not diesel. Okay, you have to have spark, you have to have gas fuel mixture or gas air mixture, okay, and you have to have compression. So we're going to go over all three of those right now. So a couple ways to check your spark. Like you're pulling and pulling and pulling and pulling and pulling, and you're like, man, I don't know if I got spark or not. Old school way is to take your spark plug, put it in the boot, ground it, try not to hold on to it because you get zapped. I don't know if I can do this so you guys can see it. Maybe you can, maybe you can't. Here, let's do, there goes those pliers. Let's go here. If you can see that, it's not a very good ground. It's all right. So yes, it has spark. Now if I'm down at the water or something like that and I'm curious, yes, I will double check it that way. But or you can buy a spark tester for $10 off Amazon. Very simple, and they work really well on these small engines. Plug your cable into there, ground it. Make sure this ground here, or this electrode, is not touching anything else. Now watch. Good spark. Believe it or not, I have blown coils in boats before. Actually, maybe twice now. Just odd as hell. I was running with my buddy Alan, I think, last year. Hang on. Twister time. We were running last year. I don't remember what boat it was. It just crapped out. Maybe it was his boat. I can't remember. We're at the lake. I think we're at the big lake. Check for spark. South of Cheese. No spark. I'm like, really? The coil went bad. Okay, just very, very odd. I don't know why. But if you're in a, not many people probably have one of these. They're $10 off Amazon. I can put the link in there if you want. It's just really hard to see this in the sunshine and hard to keep it grounded. Those are pretty nice, okay? So, that is that, pretty much for the ignition system. Your magnet over here, see, your coil's down below. Can't really show you that, but that's what this is, all right? And your mag is up here. For setting the, I don't have one. Yeah, I do. Hang on a minute. Here's a Tiger King 26. I actually like this engine. It had some issues, and I went to go rebuild it. There's nothing even in it. There's not even a piston in there right now. You can't find parts for these things anywhere. I got this off of Gizmo, and they haven't had parts for them for like a year, so I'm kind of, it's kind of stuck. But anyway, so here's your flywheel. Okay, here's your mag. So how you want to set the air gap in this for any of these engines, even on your lawnmower, it's the same principle. Loosen these two bolts, pull your magnet up, I'm sorry, your armature up, and then lay a business card in there. Push this back down. I mean, don't, you know, muscle force it down, but push this back down, snug these down, bam, set, there's your air gap. Poof, pull out the business card. That's really all you have to do. That's the perfect for all of these things. The other thing you want to make sure of, I had an engine one time, actually it was the first gas boat I ever bought. When I got back into boats years ago, I bought a Rockstar, one of those pro boat Rockstars, back those really cool ones. For RTR, it was a cool catamaran. Bought it off my neighbor that lived behind me for super cheap, and now I know why. I went to go run it. I could get it started-ish, but man, it ran like a bag of ass. I mean, you couldn't even keep it going. You would just be breaking sweats in the wintertime trying to even get this sucker to go. What had happened was the Dunsky that lived behind me, see how there's no bolt on this flywheel here? he didn't have the Paul, it's called a Paul, P-A-W-L. He didn't have that tight, or if you have a pulley on there for a belt, he didn't have that tight, but it was a pull start. So what had happened was the flywheel had backed off. This is a tapered shaft. Your crankshaft's tapered. This had lifted up a little bit, and the Woodruff key, or the, which actually look like these, okay, shaft key, that had sheared and took out the crank with it, actually, because it had mauled it up. And the timing was actually off, and I was really busting my head. I'm like, there is no way the timing can be off on one of these engines, because they don't have timing. They really don't. There's no valves, there's no reeds, but they do. When this thing makes spark, okay, it has to be keyed to that crankshaft in order to send the spark at the right stroke, at the compression stroke. So, yeah, got to watch that too. So always make sure you've got something on here. If you're not running a pull start and you're only running a belly or a pulley in the front, put a bolt, a nut on the back of it if you have to, whatever the case may be. So that is really about it for the ignition system, I'm pretty sure. If I've missed anything, please point it out. Compression, again, if you've never played with one of these engines before, if you're new to boating, it can be kind of a wild guess, because it doesn't feel like it has the compression of a lawnmower, like when you pull a lawnmower or you pull your snowblower or whatever the case. Believe it or not, though, it's the same. It's just in a smaller area. It's pretty crazy. So what I've got, so if you're used to these engines, I can go up to anybody's boat and tell the half-life, what I call the half-life of their engine. I can pull this, like, that's pretty much a brand new motor, okay? I can tell just by pulling. Oh, yeah. Beautiful, right? But if it's pulling like this, yeah, that's still good. Oh, fine. Oh, yeah. That's south of cheese. Or like if you wanted to feel what bad compression feel like, put your finger over it. Don't touch the coil. Oh, yeah. You ain't starting that. Okay? So, if you're used to these engines, you can just pull on them and check, usually. Okay? If you're not used to these engines, you can buy one of these. It's a compression test gauge for about $20 off Amazon. And it's a nice kit. Hose comes off. I think if you have multiple boats, or you really want to get into it, and you're going to be working on engines, you really want to, or you're going to make customizations, you know, and working on your motors, making them faster, trying to make sure you got good stuff going on, invest in one of these things. $20, maybe even one of these. Eh, it's pretty rare you have an ignition issue with these, but definitely one of these. $20, I think. And it comes with multiple head ports, so you can use it on your car, you can use it on your lawnmower, and you can use it on one of these. I'll put the link in the description. All right, so believe it or not, to get decent to start an engine, a two-stroke, I want to say I've started them all the way down to 40. They won't run worth a shit. They'll have no power, but they'll start. There's a difference between starting and, you know, pushing. Believe it or not, this is pretty much the same for a push mower, okay? It's 90. Around 90. It doesn't have to be, it's not going to be perfect, of course. So what you're going to do is this is going to build up compression. This is your release valve. Now watch the, I'll try and do this with one hand. You pull until it stops going up. Okay? Pretty much 90 on the nuts. The black is the PSI. The inside numbers are bar. Okay? So, you can see. Now what you want to do to really test your compression, that's really good. It's pretty much a new engine though. I think there's only maybe half an hour on it. Release it, do it again. Not too hateful, okay? So what you want is repeatability, all right? So if you do it, pump it up, boom, 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 pumps, and then it goes 90, and then next time you do it, it's 70, and next time you do it, 60, next time you do it, 75, something's not right. Two-stroke engines have to be sealed. If you have a leak, a vacuum leak, you can buy a tester for that. Excuse me, you can buy a tester for that too. I don't have one, but that if you have a vacuum leak, going to run like crap, promise. So this, you can use a, I think you can use electric start. Let's see what happens. This is my beater. My nice one I keep for the lake box. All right. Yeah, a little fast. It's like 98. Try it again. But you really should pull it. Yeah, still. Pulling it's more realistic, I think. But, of course, maybe not. I mean, with your mower, you use an electric start. Well, riding mower. Anyway, good investment. But this tells you if you've got enough compression or not. You'll be able to start this down to 50. Almost guaranteed. But that's starting it and running a boat fast is two different things. You want to be in the 90 realm. If you're sagging below 80, I would probably have a look at them rings. Look at your clearance in the ring gap. And, you know, just all sorts of normal engines. So that's a different video. So now what we're going to do is we're going to attempt to flood this thing. And I want to show you that. I'm going to try to flood this manually. Now you watch. When you don't want to flood the damn thing, you know. All right, so my bag, not much gas in it, but enough for this video. And I'm going to leave the plug off, stick it down here, and I'm going to choke it manually. Now I can see there's already a ton of gas in there because we've been drawing power. So I'm going to stick my finger in here and just flood this thing. Okay. Now, don't know if you guys noticed this coming out. That's our oil gas mixture, the super soaked plug. So that thing's should be pretty flooded. Shouldn't start. So we're gonna crank this down. I actually like these cheapo wrenches. You can buy these for like $1. I'm not kidding. I think Gizmo has them for $1. Maybe Zip does too, I don't know. These come with a lot of things. I save them. These are great for... I only use them for plugs. It's the only thing I use it for. I have them down at the lake. I have them on my bench, whatever. All right, let's try to start this guy. Hopefully it won't. All right, that is too flooded. So, if that's the case, this is a cold engine. I have not run it today. If you have run it in the last hour or two, probably it's going to fire right up without having to choke or whatever else. But you saw some dude in a video putting his hand over the carb, pulling it 3 times, and you did it down the water. Now it's flooded really bad. Here's what I do. If I'm assuming you don't have an electric start. Okay. I can get this fixed real fast with an electric start, and I'll show you that. Okay. So we're down at the water, 95 degrees out. You don't feel like pulling teeth. All right, so take your plug out. Might want to put a rag over it. Yeah, I'm going to do it just so it doesn't get the camera yucky. And we're going to aerate this. Okay, then the next thing I do, wipe off the plug. Next thing I do, I put it in about a third. And I put the plug back on. See all that coming out? Still a ton. You can also open the carb up. Wow, we really flood. Now, this does work, believe it or not. It does work. But I really flooded it. I mean, this thing's full of juice. So that doesn't start. And you can also stick the end in there a little bit. But see all that gas coming out? Now, you can also disconnect your gas, but it really shouldn't be drawing anything. A lot of times what you can do, too, is you can open your throttle all the way up. Okay. Now, you don't want to put the plug all the way in because you're going to get not necessarily a hydro lock. You could, but really, really hard to start. There we go. Hear it kick? All right. Now, realistically, I probably would have vented it one more time because that's how much gas is in it. One more. Okay. Now, vent it one more time. Now, normally, you're not going to have that much of a flood. This really should have started with probably one vent. I'm going to screw the plug in a little bit more. Let it run. That should be pretty well unflooded. Now, normal flooding situations. We just pulled a couple times and you flooded it. When you flooded it, usually just taking this out, pulling it 3 or 4 times, which I call venting, put the plug halfway in, pulled a few more times, usually fires right up. I had this whole block full of gas, so that's why it was pretty rough. Now we can crank it down. Head's a little warm. Okay. Bob's your uncle. There you go. That's how you would get rid of that. Now, another thing what we're going to do. Say you get an engine from your buddy, or you buy a boat off eBay, or you bought a boat off of a dude or dudette from the mountains. Your carburetor settings are funky. Go to start it. This will probably still run. Nope. Wow. Hear that? It wants to go, but can't. Wow. That son of a bitch said this thing worked. We took it out. He sent it to me, said it was perfect. Ain't no perfect. Okay, here's what you do. Whether you get an engine from me, an engine from eBay, an engine from brand new, or one in a used boat, your low speed needle is always closest to the engine. Always. Even on your weed eaters. Okay. Your high speed needle is always farthest from the engine. Now, they do have a little LH. Very difficult to see. Probably won't see it on camera. Your high speed needle is the main. Okay. You want to dial in your high speed needle before you even go to dial in your low. Okay. So here's what you do with any engine you get. Now, this is a 1047 carb, I believe. So stock 30. This goes for any stock Walboro carb on one of these boats, pretty much. And a 26, a 30, or a 32 cc Zenoa engine, or a Tiger King. We're gonna lightly bring it all the way in. Ooh, that was a lot. Till it gently stops. Feel a little bit of, don't force it. You've heard that 1,000 times. Do the same thing with the high, okay? Now you wanna clock it. I go in degrees. People say, oh, 22 degrees, or no. Clock degrees, 5, 10, 15, 20, okay? So, or halves. So I look at the maybe I can mark this so you guys can see the screwdriver better, okay? So we've brought in both needles, back them off 1.5 turns. So there's half, there's one, there's half. Little fatter than half is fine, by the way. Half, one, half. I guarantee that will get you a good starting place. Now, it was running a whole lot better before I screwed around with the needles. Need my drink. But if you need to get to a good starting place, I would even go more than a turn and a half. But if you want to be safe, I mean, you saw us spitting out white smoke like crazy. That's fine, but 1.5 will get you, when in doubt, 1.5. And it's easy to remember. When if I say, oh, it's 1.32, what the hell does that mean? Just, and then go in 5-degree increments. And when I say that, think of the clock. 5, 10, 15, okay? Think of it that way. Don't think literal protractor. That's too much work, okay? So, now you guys have heard me in my videos say bench tuning. Oh, yeah, I throw this in, I'm doing a maiden. All I did was a bench tune, running okay. That means I basically tuned it on the bench. I'm just maybe setting in the engine, break-in, which isn't really a break-in, but things like that. So that's what, and I, all my settings on the struts, all those things, bench settings. All right, so what we're going to do is I'm going to bring in the high-speed needle till she leans up a little bit, even though the low speed is, you'll see what I mean, okay? I am going to turn on the circulator, so we're going to fire this guy up. There she goes. Now, these little screwdrivers, I think I buy them in 12 packs out of Amazon. Yeah, working good. I buy like two of these this summer because I lose them. And they have magnets, usually, on the back. And they're strong little bastards. See, they'll stick to anything. They'll stick to plastic. All right, so here we go. So that's what I would call a bench setting. Very, very simple. You don't want to rev it to the full, that was not full RPM. Man, a little water pump does good. You don't want to rev it for a long time or without load, full throttle. You can boost it here and there like you saw me doing. Not the worst thing, but don't do it for long periods. No load on an engine going high RPM, bad things are going to happen. You're going to throw a rod, you're going to do whatever. But don't be afraid to give it like you saw me doing. So now she should fire right up. All right, so now let's turn on our radio and see what our neutral position looks like. Get it on my cat here. Okay, turn this guy on. Okay. Fire it up. Okay, that's actually pretty good for a bench setting. You got to remember, you don't want to set this thing up winding out on your bench, like full speed. Not because you're going to wreck the engine, but the thing is, if you get too lean on the bench, you're going to lack power when she's in the water, okay? So don't get carried away with bench settings. What you want to do with a bench setting, for my opinion, A, is for testing. B, getting it dialed in so like the first time you launch it just doesn't poop out and you have to go swimming for it. But it's also for throttle response. Did you hear in the beginning there when I did it, it was like, you know, type of sound. And then I dialed in a little bit. Now, I'm not under load, so I'm not taking anything for granted. But then you hit it and that throttle response is real smooth now. Woo! That was a kick. All right, so that works pretty good. For a bench setting, I don't hate it. Now, you guys have ever seen these? A little tachometer. You can buy these suckers for like 10 bucks. Oh, my battery died. Like 10 bucks off Amazon. I don't know if you guys can see that number. It's really, my battery's kind of south of cheese here. And you buy these things. A lot of guys don't like them because you have to wrap the coil, this wire, around this, your coil. You have to wrap it around 5 times, they say. No, you don't. It's a lie. It's a lie. All you have to do is take yourself a cheap-ass clamp. In this case, this is literally a clamp. But an alligator clip works perfectly fine for 5 cents. Solder it onto the end. Stick it on there. Done. And you'll see this fire up. So we're going to see what she looks like at this idle speed. Hey, what happened there? Ah, lost my radio. I'm too close. There we go. We're just going to turn off the radio. Sometimes if you're too close, your wave jumps. All right. I just learned something new. You don't need to even use the wire. You can just hold it next to it. Wow, did you guys see that? Watch this. I've never tried that. Watch. Nothing connected. I'm going to put the wire over here. I'm just going to hold it next to it. It's at 0.9. Not bad. Okay. Whatever. So, that's pretty cool. These are nice. Yeah, it's not a must-have, but it's nice for tuning. Oh, there's a light. How do you do that? Oh, you hit the button. Tell them, use this mic. You can't even see it. Sorry. I don't use it a lot. I really don't, guys. I just, whatever. Another thing that can go bad for you is your pipe vibrating loose or your carburetor, God forbid, vibrating loose. Okay? With the carburetor vibrating loose, you're going to have really inconsistent pulsing, jumping. Okay? Jumping like revving. Okay? Because what's happening is you're going from a good mix to super lean. Good mix to super lean because you're sucking air in. Okay? Or if you get water, you're going the opposite direction if you're sucking water in, which you might have seen this do the other day. So that is indicative of your carburetor vibrating loose. So if you're like, man, this thing is just, you know, just kind of going all over the place, bring her in, check that. Make sure that carburetor is nice and tight. It hand tight, but about as hard as you can with those, just about. I mean, it's aluminum, don't go nuts, but actually it's phenolic block, but same principle. So be careful with that. Excuse me. that is indicative of that. Exhaust. Now, if you're running a tune pipe and your exhaust vibrates out, you will see a speed difference. You'll definitely hear a difference. You hear this wah, 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 type sound, like it just got louder. Now it sounds like a dune buggy instead of a boat, which is not what you want, obviously. 9 times out of 10, this is human error. Like you just forgot to tighten it down, or you didn't snug it up good enough, whatever the case may be. This side here, that I have had certain engines, I don't know what it is, if it's just the angle I have it at or what. I don't have any on my current boats, but I've had it in the past. Or maybe your engine's got an excessive knock to it. Not a knock, but a vibration. Something's out of balance. Very difficult sometimes to get these guys to stay tight. And there are some tricks to it. One thing you can do is you can use a double gasket. And if you use a double exhaust gasket, sometimes it gives you that almost like a dampening effect against the metal. And it's not as nasty of a smack and vibration type of thing. Tune pipes. I'm not going to go over this because there's people out there that know it better than I do. To be quite honest, I don't dial in my tune pipes very well. I don't race. I get it so I think it's on the pipe or close to it for that day, but I don't adjust it every day. I'll adjust it at the beginning of summer, and that's it. Okay. And if your weather changes, you know, you probably have to readjust it. They're not as picky as a nitro engine. Not nearly so. When I get a gas boat dialed in the summer, and it's really rocking, and I'm not changing anything else, like strut angles, props, and things like that, I'll usually leave it until this time of year. And then this time of year, I might have to tweak it a little bit because it's pretty cold. It's like 55 degrees out compared to 95 degrees a month ago. You might have to play with that just a touch. But for tune pipes, what you want to do from this point here to this point here, the inside, let me grab a right here. Right where it comes in. Put your measure, take a piece of string, put the string here, wrap it around the header, right to here. Use a string. Then mark that with a Sharpie on the string, take the string off and measure it. That will get kind of like, or if your lady's got a seamstress tape, you know, that you do your waist width and stuff, those work really well too. That way you don't have to piss around with the string. That should be from that point to the midsection of the bell. Should be 13.5 inches for a starting point. I'm not saying that's right for every single boat, every single engine. 26 is a little bit different, but again, it's kind of like the 1.5 and the 1.5 here on the needles. Is it perfect? No. Will it get you in the zone? Yes. Whenever I build a boat, set up a boat from here to here, 13.5 inches every single time if I can do it. I have had some boats where that's nearly impossible to do, just due to the design. Or if you're using a wrap center header, which is a header like I use on my monos, which goes from here, snakes in here, and goes straight out the back. Can't do it. I don't personally think, and correct me if I'm wrong, you guys that know more than me, but I'm pretty sure you can't really get a pipe tuned in with one of those, because it's just not right. I mean, I can only get it so far up, and it's still like 14 inches out. So, but I like it coming out the back. It's a mono. It's a wave basher. I don't care about getting it that in tune. I really don't. But I'm not a racer. You know, there's different devils to different things. It's nice and cool now. So, yeah. But 13.5 is your starting point. Okay. No big thing. One of the other things that I do is when I use a dual pickup rudder. Okay. Doesn't matter which pickup goes into the head or the header. One thing I do is, see, I got two output ports. I always put the engine in the front, never in the back. The reason is, if you put the header here and the engine gets clogged up and stops, you'll never be able to see that, because the header exhaust water is covering up that hole, because it's, you're going forward, right? You're driving by yourself. So always put your engine exhaust in the front, header exhaust in the back, because you don't give a shit about the header. The header isn't going to do much. Usually the worst case, you could burn up your cowl. I don't know. I do have one of my monos where it got a little bit hot. Once I wrapped it, it was fine. So that's a good tip for that, I think. A lot of boats, I will mount the ports on the back. What boats did I do that with? Oh, my monos. I don't know. A couple of my boats. Crackers, I think, sometimes I put back there. And that's kind of nice. But what I usually do with that is I'll put the engine on the port side, or the left, and I'll put the header on the right. Doesn't really matter, because you can see both of them when you fly by. So whatever blows your skirt up. Don't put your water outlets up here, because then it just goes into your boat. You know, use your head a little bit. We talked about this in the video the other day. I always forget the damn name. I call them Vortex Stacks, but I don't think that's the right name. Venturi, whatever. I call it a Vortex Stack. I usually don't run these on boats unless it's an open cavity. I run them on crackers, usually. And this particular boat, I'm trying it on because I was ingesting a bit of water. But other than that, you don't usually use the Venturi on a boat. You can. I don't think it really hurts anything. I don't think it really helps anything. But if you have water, a little bit of water in your boat, a little foam there, a little water in your boat, and it's splashing in there, that's usually what gets you in a boat like this. It's not the external water. Outriggers, the external, and hydros, the external water gets you because your carb's hanging over. These boats, your carb's nice inside, okay? But if you do this, yeah, you know, external water's not the issue. But if you have a bunch of water in the boat from sharp turns or waves or chop, you hit some waves just right and that water bounces up, it'll see it sucked in. So this just kind of adds a little bit more, you know, leeway there. One thing that I do use, I told you guys a while back, I use radial throttle cables. Okay, I'll turn this back on. I get these from Joe at Zip Kits. I always buy the 18 inch and then I cut them down because they're usually too long, but that's okay because I never measure. And you can see it's a direct drive. So I've got my throttle laying in sideways in here, and that's it. The only devil to these that you have to be careful of, if you're not used to them, is you have to have a servo with fairly decent throw. You can't use no old Futaba thing that's, you know, does that. You have to have something that has really good throw, and you have to be able to open up your endpoint travel. You know, usually it's 100 this way, 100 this way. Or if it's on your rudder, it might be, you know, 40-40 or 40-60. On my throttles, on every single boat, it's 120 one way and 120 the other way, usually. So, and I set up my fail-safe, obviously. That if I turn off the radio, you'll see that close. Kills the engine, okay? We all know that. Don't run without a fail-safe. It never ends well. It'll be the one time. Trust me, I've done it. I don't think I've ever lost a failsafe on a gas boat. I've lost them on electrics, believe it or not. I had I don't remember what it was. I don't know. It doesn't matter. So let's see. What else can we go over? Loose carb, loose exhaust, recoil start. Let's go over the starting methods. Okay. Now, I said this the other day. My favorite scenario is having, on a normal boat, not a race boat, is having a pull start in the back and a belt in the front. If you ingest water, you're running, you're doing great, and you flip, especially a cracker box. Higher planes are actually a little bit better because they're fairly covered. Something like this, whatever. And you ingest water into that boat, you're done. You are swimming, or you're taking a rescue boat out, or you're doing whatever. What I do is one of two things. I take the plug out. That releases any pressure in the system, and I hold the boat vertical and let the water run out of that pipe. That freaking pipe holds water like a camel. I am not kidding you. I had a boat not too long ago. I don't remember which one it was. It doesn't matter. They're all the same. That thing had, it was like it had a prostate problem, man. I mean, it just peed and peed and peed and peed. It was nuts. whatever. So I tried to get it out of the pipe first, and then I pull. No plug in. I pull. Get rid of that hydrolock. Or I'll use this. But it's actually pretty hard to use this to get water out because you have to keep the boat flat unless you can hold it upside down and do that number. It's actually better to use a pull. But if you're in a hydroplane or something like that where all you've got is a belt start, it's a little bit different. So then what I'll do is I'll just put the towel over this, spark plug out, vroom, and because it will come up water and fuel and just aerate your ass, and it's not too much fun. Excuse me. So, that's what I do for that. But I like the belt start on the front if it's not a hydro or if it's not a rigger. Riggers and hydros, I only do pulley starts, and I do them in the front. This whole mechanism comes off. You screw on a pulley nice and tight, a little bit of thread lock, and use a reducible belt, spin start it, done. There are no pull starts. Less weight, less drag on the motor, whatever. Boats that are just kind of wave killers, monos, cats, you know, boats that are just a little bit more stout, I'll put a pull on them sometimes. And sometimes I don't. Just depends on my mood. But I like this because when the engine's cold, I don't even choke it. I don't. I just stick the starter in there. Boom. That's it. Done. I get these from TFL USA, TFL Online, or TFL Hobby. I've used a couple different starters. These are my favorite. I have a brand new one I bought. This one's got some issues. I run them off of a 4S. That's my garage one. But yeah, when it's a cold engine, I don't choke them. I don't do nothing. I just start them with a belt. Then, after I'm done, and say I'm out running and I run through a tank, I bring her in, I don't use the starter again. I just pull it then because it's faster. I just boom, throw it in. It's great. Everybody's got their flavor. So you can have a pull in the front. I'm sorry, a belt or no belt and just have a collet. Or you can have a pull in the back. Or you can have a pulley in the front and a pull in the back. Or you can have just a pulley in the back. Or if you have way too much money and don't care how slow your boat is, you can put one of those big, what are those things called? Something shark. It's an electric starter they make. I can't remember who makes that. You guys know what I'm talking about. It's called something shark, I think. And it's like this huge motor with this aluminum gearbox. It looks really cool, but man, what a lot of weight. Whoa. So it is actually an electric start you can put on a servo. And you stall out in the middle of the lake. You can fire it up and go. Man, I wish I could remember the name of that. Not AeroShark. Yeah, maybe it is. I don't know. Never had one. Never will. That's just pounds of weight, I think, literally. Or at least a pound. That's CG. And then you got to figure out where to stuff it in there. Nah. All right. That's something else I want to show you. Oh, yeah. So this one I probably don't even have to choke because we've already been running it. So normally, to choke a motor, these Venturis are a little good and bad. See, those? It's got those cutouts right there. So just holding your hand over it sometimes doesn't always work. I usually just stick my finger in there. What I'll do is I'll put my finger in there, or if it's a straight carb, hand flat, I pull it until it kicks. You know, like one, two, boom, 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 boom. Then I don't choke, and then I pull it, and it usually starts within two pulls after that. If I'm doing a cold start, doing a hot start, and this engine's cold right now, believe it or not, but there's still fuel in it. That's why it started up so easy. But, you know, take off the fuel, blah, blah, blah. Said the other day, we were talking about fuel supplies, gas bags. I would never run with a bag with that much air in it. This boat's been sitting. I haven't run it for a couple days. There are vapors in the gas that just make air, that just are gas, literally. So no matter how tight you get it, you got this thing just friggin' condom tight. Tomorrow you come out here, and you're going to have a little bit of air bubble in there. Next day it's going to be a little bit more. Leave it out in the sun, you're going to have even more. Okay, it doesn't happen fast, but it does happen overnight. But I would never run with one this much, even though it's a little bit higher. My air bubbles should be up. This would kill your engine. Nice thing about tanks, physical hard tanks, is when you run a tank and you're sloshing around in there, okay, you'll get a little bit of not necessarily air, but no gas, and it'll make your engine sputter, and you'll hear that sputter. Oh, we better bring her in, man, she's low. Not these. You get an air bubble, you're done. It is like brakes. One of the drawbacks to bags. Now, if you know your boat, like, I very rarely run a full bag out in one sitting without bringing it in. Really, I mean, my boats, they go a long damn time on a bag of gas. This is the size they normally run, 250. And, I mean, 20 minutes straight at least, I think, wide open. Depends on the engine, like a Redline or a 32 is a little bit different, but I usually bring it in before I run a full bag in one shot, usually. Or I just know. It's like, oh, it's been a while. Getting a hand cramp. Bring it in. Refuel. No big thing. Trying to think what else we could go over. I'm not going to go over the internals of the engine in this video. It's already been almost an hour. That's long enough. Greasing the shaft. We've talked about that in other videos. Maintenance videos and whatnot. There is a belt crank on these brackets. These are the brackets I get from Joe at Zip Hits. It's the only ones I use. I think I do have, in one of my hydroplanes, I have one of them other ones. I like trying to keep stuff the same. That way I don't have to keep bunches of extra parts. But in the case of this, there's usually brackets here that the bell crank servo hooks onto, like if you're not using this style of throttle. And I actually take a Dremel tool before I put the engine in and I cut them off because they get in the way of my belt. See that? So just a little tip. And I think that's it. I can't think of many other things. Check for spark. Compression's kind of a no-brainer. You'll know it when you pull it. Spark can be a devil. Tachometer's kind of a thing. You know, it depends on the boat. I like my boats revving a little bit high at idle. I don't like to have to babysit the trigger. So when I throw the boat in and I just want to, like, you know, I just stepped on a caterpillar and got between my toes or something, I need to look down, I want to be able to take my trigger off and my boat still goes. Slowly. Just high enough to keep forward motion. And then when you bring it in, it takes a little bit more, balls. But I don't like the super slow throttle. Sure, it sounds cool. Now, if you have a clutch, that's fine. But yeah, not so much. So anyway, if you guys have any questions or you think I've missed something, please let me know. But I think that really covers most of the troubleshooting you'll run into with these. So until then, kids, keep dry side up. Bye.